There I am now. Now I'm beginning to have everything. Not only did God allow me to get everything I thought I wanted, it far surpassed anything I ever thought it would be. I never dreamed in a million years that wrestling would become as popular as it was. I was part of the main event in a show that was broadcast on NBC. It was the first time that professional wrestling had been back on national network television in the United States since the 1950s. It was called Saturday Night Main Event. And I was right there in the middle of it. I've made appearances on The Tonight Show and Kathy and Regis. And I've wrestled in front of 80,000 people at Wembley Stadium. And I wrestled at a record-setting crowd at the Sky Dome at WrestleMania 6. I think it was 67,000. And I've traveled around the world. But I want you to know, at the pinnacle of my success, I was the most miserable man you've ever met. You see, I'm trying to fill a void. Like that dog that returns to his vomit, so the fool returns to his folly. I'd been through a failed marriage and a divorce. And I had been unfaithful in my first marriage. You see, and when the big house and the nice car and the swimming pool and the fame and the money and the recognition, when all of those things wouldn't fill the void, then I began to drink. And then I began to do drugs. By the grace of God, I was never a drug addict or an alcoholic, probably pretty close at times. I've had those days where I watched the sun come up, then the moon come up, the sun come up again without ever going to sleep. Miserable times. But if there was an addiction in my life, it was women. It was lust of the flesh. Now, I love my wife. I love my children. How could I possibly be unfaithful to a woman that I love, not once, not twice, but multiple times? Because I find out, and I understand today, that until I can come to peace with that person I see looking back in the mirror, I can never truly love anybody. And I was trying to fill a void. And you can rationalize anything. Anything. Sin will always do three things in your life. It'll always take you further than you wanted to go. It'll always hold you there longer than you wanted to stay. And it will always cost you more than you wanted to pay. Ultimately, the Bible says the wages of sin are death. So with all that I had and all that I had been blessed with, God blessed me with this wonderful wife. God blessed me with two more children, my sons Teddy and Brett. God gave back to me the son from my first marriage, Michael, who came to live with us when he was 13. I couldn't have been more blessed, and I couldn't have been more ungrateful. Why? Because I was consumed with self. But our Heavenly Father, like any good father, I mean, why did God give us the family? Everything that is here, everything that he's given us is an illustration. Because we're part of his family. He is our Heavenly Father. And I know as the parent of three sons that there are times in the lives of my boys where I've had to say, okay, son, you think you're smarter than me? Go ahead. I'm going to let you go. Go do it your way. I'll be here when you get back with your tail tucked between your legs to pick up the pieces. Our kids, when they become teenagers, all of a sudden we become stupid. All of a sudden, mom and dad don't know anything anymore. They're not in touch. They're not with it. No, we've only been around about 30 years longer than you have. We've already thought about doing or have done what you're thinking about doing or you're doing. But we're stupid. And then when we catch them in the middle of it, they go, duh. That deer in the headlights look. Uh-oh. Sometimes you have to give your kids enough rope that they hang themselves. And our Heavenly Father does the same thing. You know, we tell our kids, and I tell my boys, I don't give you rules. I don't set limits on your life because I want to be a killjoy. I'm not trying to keep you from having fun. I'm trying to keep you out of trouble. I'm trying to protect you because I've been there before you and I know what's out there. And God yells at us from heaven, I'm only the God of the universe. I've only been around forever. And I've given you the standard to live by. Not because I want to be a killjoy. Not because I don't want you to have any fun. How did Jesus say it? I came that you have life and have it how? More abundantly. If you just play by the rule book. But like that teenager, I had to do it my way. I kept trying to fill that void. And it got worse and worse. Until one day, in God's perfect timing, he pulled the rug out from under me. March 1992, Indianapolis, Indiana, WrestleMania 8. I was part at that time of the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions. I was tagged up with a character. His real name is Mike Rotundo, but his wrestling name was IRS, Irwin R. Scheister. What a combination, the Million Dollar Man and the IRS. Yeah, wrestling's real. Yeah. So we have our big event there that day at the RCA Dome in Indianapolis, and I go out that night and I party all over the city, bar to bar, strutting around the Million Dollar Man in all my cool glory. Oh, I was cool. You know how I spell cool today? Capital F-O-O-L. Fool. Just want to share that with some of you cool guys. I can say it to you because I've been there. And if you think life's about being cool, you're going to reap what you sow, pal. And I did. I didn't go to bed that night. I went straight to the airport, caught a plane to Detroit, checked into the Marriott Hotel. And then, at about noon that day, I walked to a phone in the hotel lobby to call home and check in. What a nice guy. What an absolute moron. What a jerk. But that day, on the other end of the phone, was a very angry woman. My wife. My faithful wife. My wife, who had never called me in the middle of the night to check up on me anywhere because she trusted me. My wife, who thought I was a godly man. My wife, who had bore two children for me, who had taken my son as her own son and blended him into our family wonderfully, just as I had been loved by a stepfather. That wife now wanted some answers because she had discovered an affair and then another. And then another. I said, I don't want to talk about this on the phone. I'll be on the next plane home. I wanted time to think about what I was going to say. And at the time, obviously, I was trying to think about what lie I was going to tell. But her response was, no, you won't. You don't live here anymore. Click. And the first words out of my mouth were, oh, my God, what have I done? The first thing I did was cry out to God. What a hypocrite. Oh, God, help me. Oh, God, come off of that shelf where I've left you for all these years after you've been so good to me. Come down off that shelf now and help me because now I'm desperate. Did I deserve any help? Absolutely not. But I want you to know that I don't care how bad you are. I don't care how miserably you failed. I don't care as you sit in this room how bad you think you are or how miserably you failed or how many times you have failed. When you cry out to God and you cry out to him from the depths of your heart, he'll come running and meet you every time. Every time. The next call that I made was to a man who's my best friend today. His name is Pastor Hal Santos. I met Hal in a gym in Baton Rouge in 1981. This man of God prayed for me for 11 years. He made himself available to me. He didn't call me and beat me over the head with a Bible like a lot of religious people do. He loved me. He just loved me. He just befriended me, and he made himself available. And in my darkest hour, I didn't call my pastor at home, who I had a good relationship with. I called a man who had poured a lot of time into me. I called Hal, and I said, Hal, I need you. I've ruined my life forever. And I told him the story. He said, I'll call Melanie and I'll call you back. He made arrangements for us to both fly to St. Louis, where he pastors a church across the river in Illinois. I got off that airplane in St. Louis and took the longest 30-minute ride of my life to go face my wife, who was now waiting at his home to confront me. Pastor Hal, what do I say? What in the world do I do? And I'll never forget what the man of God told me that day. And I share it with you here today, and I hope that it speaks to somebody. He said, number one, Ted, remember this. Sin will always do those three things. It's always going to take you further, always going to cost you more and hold you longer than you ever anticipated. Ultimately, the wages of sin is death. And the Bible says, Ted, that you're going to reap what you sow. So know this. What I'm about to tell you is no guarantee of saving your marriage. It may cost you everything. But Jesus said, the truth will set you free. If you'll trust him today, the way you trusted him when you were 15 years old and your father died and your mother became an alcoholic, if you'll put that same faith in him today, even at the cost of your marriage, number one, he's going to forgive you and he will restore you. And he didn't promise me a quick fix. He didn't promise me pie in the sky. He said, God's going to take you through the fire, pal. He said, but if you will be faithful through the fire and let him purge you in that fire, you'll come out with a peace in your life, the Bible says, passes all understanding. He'll restore you, Ted. Folks, I want you to know in my heart of hearts, I'm not here saying, Lord, restore my marriage, save my marriage, give it all back to me, and I'll serve you. I said, Lord, I'm here to say, I'm tired of being here. I'm tired of coming back to this place. You see, I'd been through a divorce. And just like that dog that returns to his vomit, just like that fool returns to his folly, there I was again. I said, I don't want to be here anymore. I don't want to look in that mirror anymore and not like that person I see looking back. I'm not going to drown. I don't want to drown it out. I don't want to drown out my conscience with booze and drugs anymore. I said, God, I don't want to lose my family. I love my wife. I love my children. And you and I both know that I haven't been living like I do. But you know my heart, and you know that I really love them. I said, but if that's the price that I must pay, then I accept it because I deserve it. Now, Lord, give me the strength to do what I must do. Help me in this moment to be a man. And my pastor buddy, I'm telling you, folks, he had to literally push me through the door to face my wife, who's about this tall. I couldn't take my eyes off the floor, and I couldn't look her in the face. Million-dollar man, Learjets, limousines, blonde hair, 260 pounds, best shape of my life. On the outside, the picture of worldly success. On the inside, an empty shell.